I'm going to be speaking not about my specialty, which I love to talk about on the side, which is nematodes and soil, and instead talk about the commonalities I see with soil biodiversity and what its status is compared to what you all are learning and know here. This is a mic, for those of you who don't know, taken by Valerie Behan-Pelletier. It's a soil mic. And I, as you can see, come from Colorado and in the Northern Hemisphere, particularly in the Rocky Mountains right now. We are looking at snowfall. And it's very simple to talk to people about snow, but not so simple to talk to them about soil species. For example, I frequently get cards with snowflakes on the front that say, oh no, snowflake has another one just like it. But in actuality, this particular snowflake is the head of a bacterial feeding soil nematode. They're quite different, but it's a little hard to talk to people about why I care about soil biodiversity. So what I want to do today is talk about why soil biodiversity. And part of it is because we want to move all these organisms that we know something about. We know a little enough to be dangerous, but we haven't put it all together. Move it to the world stage. Secondly, I think we have to face and think about more often that soils themselves globally are in a crisis. About 33% of the land surface is degraded. Some of it looks to be irreparable, depending on what we can do with pollutants. The time is short. We need soils. We need soils for lots of reasons, which I hope to show you just by talking about soil biodiversity. And our progress is slow. And we think that what we're going to learn here, what you're going to share and what I'm seeing in the talks here, this is going to help us resolve some of our problems of things that we know about and even help lead us further afield for something like a global soil biodiversity assessment that would just give us the status and trends. So specifically, what I'm going to talk about is the Global Soil Biodiversity Initiative, which is relatively young, what it does, some of the advances and frontiers in soil biodiversity science, and then moving forward to help use this information for sustainability challenges. And I want to go back to the second one and just give a caveat right away. If I don't cite your paper, it's not because I didn't think it was good. It's just probably because I just selected some. They're not all mine, but I just selected some. And so I'd be very interested in hearing of other papers and other ways that I can use for presentations. Okay, what is the Soil Biodiversity Initiative? Well, it's started by scientists, mostly volunteers. It's recognized by the UN Convention on Biological Diversity, who gave the challenge to study soil biodiversity or to do status and trends to FAO. That was about in 2002, before I got involved. Our interest, the number of scientists that are interested in this, all lands, pole to pole. And right now, the Secretariat is very much like Eyeball. It starts where people are interested and you have some volunteers. And all of us who are involved, we thank our universities because we don't really have funding. Now, why soil biodiversity? It's estimated that a quarter of living diversity on Earth is below ground. Much of what we hear about is only in the top 10 centimeters of soil. There are some rare studies that go at depth, with rooting depth, but most of it is above 10 centimeters. We now know that this soil life does a lot. Clean air and groundwater, think about dust movement. Think about erosion control. Think about disease mitigation, all the controls that exist in soils on other organisms. Many of these are plant, animal, and human diseases that have controls. And so we're interested in taking what we know to help in policy and management. But we also want people to recognize that soil biodiversity isn't just a line at our feet. When you walk out on soils, you're walking on organisms that are working as sources of food for wildlife. Many endangered species feed on organisms in soil, so there's a connection there. They suppress, there's other controls, as I mentioned, on pathogens. Right now, there's tremendous interest on carbon storage in soil and how can we increase that amount of carbon stored through biota. And of course, for numbers of years, all the way back to the beginnings of agriculture, people, farmers, everyone has been interested in how we feed ourselves and how does soil fertility get enhanced by below ground diversity. So we started as a small group. This is pretty much it. I thought I'd give credit to them because, as I say, we don't have any major grants that are funding us. It started with this one bunch, but now we have people representing the GSBI, 1,300 participants in over 111 countries. Go to our website, sign up, tell us what you do. We welcome knowledge. But the original idea that came to us when we were at a meeting, very much like this, and I can only imagine that eyeballs started when people started talking together and thinking, so we have some common ground again, was that we needed a GSBI because literally I could read various policy agendas or either hear about them that were global that totally ignored the life in soils. And it was just enough to make us say, hey, we've learned a lot in the last, we're no longer a black box. We know a lot about what's going on. So the intersection of these policies that I've got up there, whether it's the Framework Convention on Climate Change that I just mentioned, the UN Convention to Combat Desertification, World Health Organization with its soil transmitted ailments, the UN Convention on Biological Diversity, food security, all of these, soil biodiversity research, we feel, has an avenue to inform these policies. We want to see soils in its crisis, but some solutions. And we think, we hope, some of our knowledge will help. So we have lots of links with partners, nothing official. We don't belong to anyone, kind of independent. So what do? Well, almost everything, policy, education, outreach, just baby steps, but we're there. For example, here is where we were asked, which was flattering to begin with, they existed, they knew we existed, but they asked us to contribute to a working paper. This was from the UNCCD, Convention to Combat Desertification, and they asked for some information on soil biodiversity, erosion, how water percolated through soil, rooting depths, and we could take the literature and ask collaborators, just write some of our members and say, what are the recent papers or reports that you know that we can contribute? Also, the IPBES, we contributed expert opinion on the assessment on land degradation, and the global assessment will be coming out next year. In addition to that, we have conducted side meetings at a lot of the UN COP meetings from Rio, Nairobi, Cancun, just to inform people about soil biodiversity. And when I say soil biodiversity, we are including microbial biodiversity. I'll now be including protease biodiversity if I can get a good slide. But everything that we can try to take and highlight about what our status of knowledge is. We also conducted just recently our second conference in Nanjing. We had 1,000 people, 47 countries. This is quite astounding to me. The first conference was held in Dijon 3 years prior to that. I didn't want to get involved in having to think about this for years and years and years. We expected 200 people, my colleagues who are mostly nematologists, to show up in Dijon. We had 700 plus. 60% of them were younger than 35. There are people who are looking into this black box of soil and trying to find the scientific research that we didn't have 20 years ago without molecular tools. One of our charges has been a partnership with the EU Joint Research Center, and this is the Global Soil Biodiversity Atlas. This is a huge book, it's free. We had 120 scientists. Well, they didn't know when they came to Fort Collins, Colorado, that they were going to become authors, but they soon decided that they would help write this atlas. And as you can see, it has had tremendous publicity, 4 million views online. We're quite pleased with it. It received an award from the EUJRC last year. And Alberto Argazi is deserving of all the awards that come with this citation. The book starts with soil as a habitat and explains all the differences in heterogeneity of soil and why we do see different communities in all soils. But it also went further and tried to get the first estimation of soil biodiversity, the first distribution globally, and also the potential threats using such things as invasive species. There are soil organisms that are invasive species, not only microbes, but also flatworms. And there's a whole section on ecosystem services and mitigations to prevent or to protect soil biodiversity, different ways you can do this. So there's text with each one of these pictures, and the pictures are downloadable. In terms of education, we had a launch at Nairobi, the United Nations Environmental Program. But what has been great is that the scientists that are members of the GSBI have taken it further and to their parliaments, to the French Academy of Agriculture, the Brazilian Soil Science, and these are only a few examples of where they use the book to take to various congresses and let people know about it. But the knowledge gaps is what we really concentrate on. One of the most interesting to me has been a blog. And usually you might not think of soil biodiversity or soils and land management and sustainable land management or human well-being as being a target for blogs, but we have requests. We don't have to hunt for many people to come onto the blogs. We've got them lined out up until February. People request to say, hey, I've got a new paper out. I'd like to explain that a little bit more and the reasoning behind it and the weaknesses, or they just have something that they want to say about their favorite group. Here is just a Web of Science search for, since 1988, on the words sustainability, climate change, global change across the top, ecosystem processes, ecosystem function, et cetera, with the word soil biodiversity. And in most cases, they're going up. We can see that some of them aren't going up very far, but at least soil biodiversity, people are starting to think about life in soil and the organisms and what they contribute. And I think one of the knowledge gaps is so common with what you all have been talking about is the taxonomic impediment. And I couldn't stand here knowing that I was going to Antarctica in a week for my field season without showing you the McMurdo Dry Valleys, where soil invertebrates are the highest animal taxa. And it's a good example to show you what I think is typical of a lot of us here. Here are the heads of three nematode species. We have four barcodes. It's a little hard to see over here, but one in yellow, pink, and blue, and white. We have to align those differences, the morphological characteristics with the barcodes. What are we gonna do there? And this is, I think, very typical of what other people are seeing. And so this is a big problem, even in a place where there is so little diversity. Now I want to go through a series of papers to just show you the various topics that people are working on, give you some examples to fit back into all the policy strategies. Here's a couple on carbon cycling. These, you can see the headlines that the soil fauna do help with litter decomposition. These are experiments where they're excluded or they're put back or allowed in to decompose litter, leaf litter. And then also the responses of soil biota directly to climate change, warming, nitrogen deposition. Agricultural productivity is a big one. This is a field. The first top one in the Journal of Applied Ecology is with Franz Bender and Vanderhagen. And it looked at soil biota in the field and looked at nutrient leaching, crop yield and found increases there. The bottom one looked at one group of taxa, lots of species of taxa, soil microarthropods, and how they supported carbon sequestration. Even modeling, I never thought I would see this. I used to work with a bunch of modelers and they would just say, well, it's okay, it's included, it's in that black box over there. And they just put in a figure. Now it's looking that we're going into much more, there are many more papers and many more discussions at meetings about can we predict soil carbon more accurately if we consider microbes and fauna.
But the moment they go brighter, I have to come down.
Perhaps one of the most telling steps in how we're going is thinking about all the fauna together as soil biodiversity. And this is a little complicated paper, but I would advise going to read it. What this paper says is that the way I've been studying my nematodes in soil, just soil nematodes, targeting one group in what they do, say bacterial feeding nematodes, which would be like the bacteriovores, three up from the bottom. These are all the trophic groups this paper considered.
They're not going to edit them.
That isn't really as important is what it's with in terms of the multiple functions that you get out of these animals and plants. So here was, this study was 9 trophic groups. It looked at 14 ecosystem services and functions. It was 150 grasslands, over 4,600 taxa. These are morphological. And again,
but it was in the venue as well.
The key take-home on all this is
this
it's better to look at multiple taxa and their functions to see what happens. There were only a few cases, and that's the bar on the far right, where you saw that predators had a negative effect on a function, or richness, disease richness or abundance had an effect as a single group. Then when you take this further and look at everything in the soil, here is a recently disturbed on the left, circle with, I'll explain that in a second, and then a long-term study of restoration. This is Ellie Morin's work. I just think it's so cool because it's got archaea, bacteria, root-feeding nematodes, mites, plant mites, some omnivores, all the way up to Incotraeans, earthworms, Calimbula, and you can see that as it's more restored, the connections start building between a number of the different taxa. There have been more and more studies pointing out what these emerging frontiers are. I'm not saying that every soil is going to act this way. What I'm trying to show is where people are tackling the gaps in our knowledge. Here is another one that they looked at a number of papers and called this a call to action. And they looked at the increase in papers, publications, on invasive species, natural disturbances, and climate change since 1991 over to 2015 is the far right. And you can just see how the papers in soil microbiology, the soil microbial ecology have increased and the fauna are very slowly gaining. There have been a number of global distribution, just looking at the global patterns of species. This top one, I can kind of use as a disclaimer, I was involved in that. We did it from pole to pole and through South Africa also. It was 454. These are, some of them are old, that would probably need to be repeated. But this is quite interesting.
Because if you look at
there is a rush by both the taxonomic community, the metabolic, the barcoding community, to find out what is the distribution of light. We haven't had that in soil as much as we're seeing now. People use this top one I realize now is a little hard to see. It's just a very early paper. I would call it early. It's 2011 by Noah Ferrer et al. It says that microbes do not follow elevational transects. So people are looking at above ground theory and seeing if low ground theory matches.
I zoom into open
we also have one that I think you probably are aware of about termite mounds. What causes resilience in soils? Is this one factor? And so in this case, they studied it across a large spatial gradient. So another thing is not only global, globally are we looking at patterns, but there have been a number of regional assessments. This one is more complete than what's mapped. Archaea bacteria were looked at it for South Africa. This was a volunteer. This is not new sampling. They took the data that already exists and are putting it together. Another one is about threats. This is about in Europe, what are the threats of intensive agriculture? And conventional tillage also decreases the abundance of earthworms. So a lot on trying to quantify what we know. There are, as you can see on this one, both above and below ground, that just came out, many different groups that are starting to say, what are going to be the standards for assessments? Or we're already doing one, this is the standard we used. We need information, or I think the GSBI wants information on what do you do. There are many microbiome projects coming. I'm only going to mention a few here, and I would point out that the EU is about to do one with a lot of samples starting in 2018. They're going to be doing sequencing of prokaryotes and eukaryotes. But here is one, two of the microbiomes. The one on the left here is at the University of Pretoria here in South Africa. The one on the right is the China Soil Microbiome Initiative that just started and it's got its 4 points or what it's looking at there. I think both of those are mostly microbial. There has been the European one that was part of a big EcoFinders group where they looked at land use across Europe in biogeographic zones. And so there's different reasons people are using these and calling for these. In the US, we've been pushing for a synthesis that would tell us where certain plant pathogens are. There's no database for that. Australia has its what they call BASE, the Biome of Australian Soil Environments. This is distributed data collected together. People can go online and find where it is, and it sounds like that's very much what several people here have talked about. The GSBI has instigated working groups and trying to pull together data. This paper in Frontiers summarizes a workshop that was held in Leipzig at the Synthesis Center for Biodiversity, and that idea of having distributed data sets and a way to link where the data is on various organisms and on various management practices with organisms is being tested now first with the global earthworm data. This project has met twice and they've gone into museums to find the species. They've done all sorts of scans to find where earthworm species are beginning with Darwin or before. So why now for this Global Soil Biodiversity Initiative? I think first we all talked in our little taxonomic groups. We had nothing like this conference and we go to either our ecology groups or our agricultural group or whatever our meetings are, our scientific affiliation is. But I think now we've got a real progress to be made if there is a global soil biodiversity assessment that really comes across, and I don't know if it'll happen, but this was mentioned at China, the China meeting that they called, the FAO and the EU and some others called for a global biodiversity, soil biodiversity assessment. What the GSBI would do would be to try to find out where there are sources of data that are either published or non-published that we can help provide information to that assessment. So it's not only the distributed data, but we're also thinking of a trait bank because there's so much knowledge in ecology about even earthworms and whether they move and which direction and what they do. I think the other thing we see as knowledge gaps is filling out this who, where, and what do they do. Why we should care is difficult for people. I mean, when you're seeing an elephant out here, it's really difficult to go back and say, okay, everybody, get really excited about this thing you can't see in soil. the cross-disciplinary approach for spatial scales, putting this information together on the ecology, bringing the taxonomists, the morphologists, the systematists together, we've got a lot to share. And I think there needs to be more global collaborative experiments on responses to climate change, such as there exist already above ground drought networks that are becoming global in arid lands. It's very simple to take a soil sample underneath one of these replicated standardized chambers across the world and compare ore in flooding or other things, and then long-term observations are going to be key. So kind of in summary, what I've tried to do is to explain to you that the soil community of life has come together in a way and with a speed that we didn't expect. We want to highlight everything, and we want you to remember that we can't breathe, eat, drink, or be healthy if we don't have sustainable soils. Thank you very much.
Sorry. Thank you, Diana. Do we have any questions?
Thank you, Diana, for that wonderful overview. I have a question about what your relationship is with NEON in the U.S. I don't know, you didn't mention them specifically, but I assume that they're part of this in some way. I'm curious.
Well, we're part of them.
You're part of them, okay.
Yeah, they already have a series of soil samples that they're taking across. NEON, the question was, what do we have to do with NEON, which in the U.S. is the National Environmental Observation Network. They're down the road from us, and they don't give us any money, but they are aware of what we want to do with observations. They have a number of sites across the U.S. and elsewhere, and at present they have certain taxa that they're sampling for, and so they're not doing all of the sampling that we would be doing.
They don't do it anymore, they do it in front.
Yeah.
So you just take it to the front and they will do it there.
Thank you for the great talk. I'm totally with you on the importance of soil biodiversity, and it's a fantastic initiative to have so many researchers in so many countries involved in the global soil biodiversity initiative.
I'm just doing video.
Global Biodiversity Information Facility is really a welcoming contribution from soil biodiversity scientists.
They will help you.
I just made quick checks of gbif.org, and the soil biodiversity is very underrepresented. So
I think we've had the first workshop in Leipzig and the second workshop in Leipzig. We had somebody from GBIF there, but I can't tell you. Right.
So
now.
Let's talk. Great talk. Thank you very much.
Yeah. No. We welcome more. That's one of the reasons I thought it was so exciting to be able to present today, is because you guys have got all these ideas, and maybe will keep us from going down the wrong path.